With some alarm, people were starting to notice that overfishing was really the cause of the destruction of all these fisheries. So that led to some regulations to protect spawning grounds, but at about the same time, the waste from lumber mills and pulp mills and other pollution sources were starting to create a lot of fish kills and a lot of trouble. This is a historic picture from 1918 of one day's catch of ciscos in Lake Erie. Ciscos have been extinct, commercially extinct in Lake Erie for many decades now. So in 1908, the Georgian Bay fishery collapsed. In 1924, Walter Kelce, working here on campus and in the museum, tried to call attention to the fact that the lake herring, or cisco, were about to go extinct, commercially extinct, if something was not done about it. The next year, the Lake Erie herring fishery collapsed to 3,000 tons from the previous year's catch of 16,000 tons. So jumping ahead now to the 1950s, when, am I the only one that was here then? The deepwater chub, the blue pike became extinct, several other species of chubs, which old folks will remember as smoke chubs, or if you've traveled around Lake Superior, you've encountered smoke chubs, because three species of these fish still exist in Lake Superior because it's so big and so deep and so cold that the extinctions have not been as serious up there. And in the 1960s, as I mentioned, the alewives finally took over the Great Lakes. Chinook and coho salmon were introduced to eat them, which they did. 1988, zebra mussels, quagga mussels, round gobies, tube-nosed gobies were introduced in freighters, ballast water over near the locks. I think you all know how that works, but in order to come across the ocean so as to be seaworthy and stable, these ships, freighters, have to take in thousands of gallons of water to fill special tanks in the bottom of the boats, so that they're stable in the transoceanic voyage. Then when they get to the locks, of course, they've got all that extra weight. They can't get through the locks. They've got to do something with it. They pump it out. There are people now whose job it is to go down in some of these things with scuba tanks. You don't want that job. And look for invasive species. But this is not the right way to solve the problem. And the attempts by biologists to get Great Lakes legislators to pass laws that would require that somehow the water be sterilized or filtered. There are many good suggestions for what to do. None of this can get past the legislature because the freighter industry is just too powerful. So we haven't done anything about it yet. So these are some of the things that we want to consider for our future. We want sustainable lake whitefish, walleye, and perch in the fisheries, but of course, biodiversity people want a lot more than that. But if we can solve these problems, the biodiversity, most of it will follow and be okay. But probably the most important thing we need to do is to stop industrial pollution, pesticides, fertilizers, factory farms that are releasing manure into the streams, and municipal pollution, because we still have dozens of serious toxic waste sites and pollution sites in the Great Lakes, in addition to all of the point source and non-point source phosphates that are causing eutrophication of the waters. that is happening on a much faster level than greenhouse gases are warming the climate. But among the things we have to do related to this, of course, is that we want to somehow be activists working for reducing the number of greenhouse gases and striving for sustainable clean energy. We need to stop invasive species, especially in ballast water. We need to manage the harvests, which we're now doing as biologists and managers much better than in the earlier days, so that we don't have the same level of overfishing. But this requires, since we're putting fishermen out of jobs here by doing this, we need some social investment that will probably require reducing the exports. I think the idea of feeding ourselves locally applies to fisheries as well as vegetables. It's something to consider, and I think we need to consider it because of that history that I just recounted for you that shows the seeming increased frequency of the various assaults on the Great Lakes ecosystem. So this is a little map that Dave Jude gave me here of the density of mysis, that opossum shrimp, in the Great Lakes. They're greatly reduced, but this map shows something else. It shows not only serious reduction, Lake Huron's fishery has been really wiped out by zebra mussels and quagga mussels, but it also shows something else, a serious instability. This is following mysis through spring and summer of 07 and 08, and so the instability is shown by the fact that these populations are jumping around by hundreds of percent. Although the zebra mussels and quagga mussels are stable, covering the bottoms of the Great Lakes, and there's something interesting going on here, something maybe tragic, maybe there will be a bright spot, because one of the things that zebra mussels and quagga mussels do is between them to provide a lot of little cracks and crevices for zooplankton to hide, so that something might be developing here with the bottom zooplankton. But the key to what happens in the next few years really depends heavily on the interaction of Diaporia, the little amphipod, and the possum shrimp with the quagga mussels, and of course, following this with great interest, the ability of the whitefish to somehow increase the learning. This is something that requires these fish to learn. They're not evolving this fast. They're learning to capture these quagga mussels with the softer shells and the fast growth. As the quagga mussels completely smother out the zebra mussels. So things are happening so rapidly that there will be almost big news about Great Lakes' future every year. There could be serious, severe changes. Just two more fish pictures. This is the round goby that we've talked about, picture by Dave Jude. These are fish that are 4 or 5 inches long that have become the staple in the diet of smallmouth bass.